Okay, so this is basically where we're at right now. Here we are at the TAP conference, and some of us know if we have a really good chance of getting an award. Some of us are kind of on the teeter totter of maybe we will, maybe we won't. We'll see how it goes. So we'll fast forward to Thursday, right? Thursday, the board vote says done. Okay, so we got awards. Congratulations, by the way, on that. Thank you. So now the fun begins, right? Relative term, but really the clock starts ticking at this point. So you've got to really spin up with your architect and your engineer, and you've got to get your final plans drawn up. And those things, that's where if you did your research, your due diligence early on, you really won't have too many surprises coming at you. But I mean, tell me if I'm wrong, but there's always going to be some big surprises that show up right about that time. Typically with me, it's always with the engineering firm. I don't know if you have architect issues, but with us, the engineer all of a sudden throws something out there that we were not actually expecting, so we have to kind of jockey a little bit around. But you want that almost on a fast forward pace, because you're trying to also meet the closing date, like we were talking about earlier. Usually we try with our company to try to close, get all the equity partnerships set up and the lender partnerships set up, vendor sorters or the bids, I guess, if you will. We try to get all that set up so we can get to our closing by the end of the calendar year. And I don't mean to offend anybody, but there are lawyers and bankers involved. So trying to get something done in the month of December can be a little bit tricky, like herding cats. Exactly. So sometimes that does tend to roll into right around the first of the year. But that's what we try to shoot for, because we want to start scratching dirt up as quickly as possible. One of the things, and then, you know, this is something that you kind of set up with your lender and your equity provider too, is, you know, you establish this timeline of when you expect to start to finish, to have that project complete. So partnering with that equity provider, one of the things that you want to make sure that y'all hammer out, or that you have to hammer out at that point, is part of these tax credits that we've been awarded. How are we going to get those delivered? What's the delivery schedule for that? One thing that you also want to try to make sure you talk to your equity provider about are adjusters. There's pretty much always going to be some type of adjuster, and you want to try to hammer that out ahead of time instead of really getting caught short at the end of your project, because let's just say it got rained out for about 2 months, so you fell a little bit behind on your project trying to get it done. So you know, you don't want to get a huge sticker shock, if you will, at the end based on adjusters. Partnering with a lender, that's again something that you kind of will already have the groundwork a little bit laid out for you as part of the application process. If this is when you start locking that in, and then closing on the land, on your construction loans with your lender. And then I believe there's a slide coming on the 10% test. Is that right? Okay, so we won't get into the details of that, but that, remember what I said when I say 10% test, because that's coming up. And then basically, you know, like I said, you're going to go with that timeline that you're going to establish with your lender, with your equity provider. You're also going to want to work with your local, the government, the local city, community, because they're going to want to know how long are you going to, is this going to take? So you have certain expectations that are going to be met there as well. And one of the things that, at least, and this is in specifically, I can talk to rural Texas, is cities providing a little bit of skin in the game. They'll offer up a lot of in-kind contributions. Hey, we'll bring water and sewer to the site for you, and we'll waive your permit fees or you know, whatever. There could be a number of things. When you get awarded these tax credits and you're ready to get everything rolled out and you're ready to start having saws running and sawdust flying, you want to make sure that you work with that city or with your local government, it may be the county, you want to work with them to get that timeline for those in-kind contributions worked out as well. Because it can be really awkward when you're getting your development all worked up and then the fire marshal comes out and says, this looks great. Where are your fire hydrants? So, oh, the city's providing those. When? That's an excellent question. So you go to the city and they're like, oh, well, yeah, we were going to wait and pay for that at the very end of the project. So then you start running into a lot of, I mean, it's not necessarily that drastic, but it could be. It could be something as simple as you're ready to start occupying some units and you still don't have your city water tap brought in. So just, you know, things that seem obvious, but it's real easy to fall through the cracks on.
Chris? Yeah, I'd just like to add that one of the most important things for us is to make sure that you work to make sure that the equity partners that you're bringing in are people that you've worked with. I mean, this business is a relationship business, so you have to really work to make sure that you establish good relationships. You know, we've always gotten the deal done, but I remember back in 2006 where we had a project that was locked in and ready to close, and about 2 days before the closing, the equity provider said, hey, we're just not going to be able to close that deal. And, you know, it's a really frustrating thing when you have to, you know, circle back and try to find somebody else. So I'm not saying that, you know, Dan is the best, but, you know, you just get to know your equity provider. Make sure that you have worked out a deal that works for you. And as he said before, focus on the things that don't seem that important. It's not always about price. It's about the ability to get the project done. It's about the timing of the money. And making sure that you've taken into consideration the adjusters for the project. And the other thing is as a working with lenders, I think you should really, you know, sort of evaluate your appetite for risk. One of the things that people really don't think too far into is, you know, if I'm going to build this project, it's going to require that I have a $10 million construction loan, or on my project, and I'm going to show you a $30 million construction loan. And, you know, if you go with a conventional lender, that loan has got some level of recourse to the principals and to the guarantors. So you really need to think through how you want to structure the project to make sure that it's best structured for you and your family and your company. So the next thing really is, you know, I think you already went through closing the loan and going through the construction process, but the one thing that I wanted to add is just making sure that you're doing things timely, and ultimately they're going to talk about the 10% test, but we've always did our best to close the project ahead of the 10% test so that we don't have any issues with TDHCA, and make sure that we meet all those requirements. So that's pretty
much all I have. Okay.
You want to picture it
up? Let's make a deal.
That's great.
Okay. Yeah. And now the real fun begins.
Can you hear me, Ann?
Okay. So now we're going to try to pitch a deal. In all reality, it never happens this fast as we're going to fast forward it here. Typically, we at least as developers like to be taken out to dinner, a few cocktails or something like that before we, you know, get into this. But we'll go with the first. I'm just now looking at the slide and seeing that I've never met a deal I didn't like. All right. I like that. I will not deny that. I never like to say no to a deal, especially one of my own. So we're going to do a rural 9% deal up in Region 1. We do already have a property in Region 1, so we do have some experience up in that area. Mm-hmm. As you can kind of see from the aerial view there, we're just on the edge of, you can't necessarily tell if that's the whole town, but that's basically the edge of town there, so we're on the west side of town. And we want to do a senior development. That's what we put together. What we look at with our, as I discussed earlier, we did our, you know, preliminary market study, full market study. So we're looking at 60 units is what we feel like we can support. Without going into all the full detail of it, we'll just kind of hit the bottom lines on this. Our potential gross monthly income, we're projecting to be $37,245, so a little over $37,000. Our effective gross monthly income comes out to $34,000. So once we, you know, have a potential for some occupancy opening or vacancies, I should say, maybe some people who didn't pay their rent on time, etc. Effectively, that puts our gross annual income at about $413,000. Okay, annual operating expenses, we're putting those at just under $240,000. So our expense to income ratio puts us at 57.83. And then our net operating income before debt service, 174,360. So our annual debt service is going to be 139,488. Debt coverage ratio of 1.25. So our net cash flow, we're going to be looking at estimating 34,872. Under our sources and use, I'm not going to sit here and read all of that to y'all, but we're estimating the total use of funds to come out at 7.8, just under 7.9. We've already had some preliminary discussions with our potential lending institution, so these numbers I'm putting out there have already been pre-discussed. So this is where you come in.
All right, no, this is great, thanks. And first and foremost, thank you for giving me the opportunity to take a look at the deal. As you know, currently in the LIHTC market, the market is extremely strong, and so we're seeing just about every deal get done. And so there's a healthy appetite out there for deals. So before I dive into to questions, just for the audience, you can't hear. How's that? Is that better? Okay, let me scoot this closer. Okay, there we go. Is that okay? So how we raise money on the equity side is either through multi-funds or proprietary. And so as I'm looking at a deal, I'm thinking to myself, is this going to be a fit for a particular proprietary buyer, which is someone that probably has a strong CRA demand for a particular area? And on a proprietary fund, they're going to buy the whole deal and want that whole deal. And when they buy proprietary, what they're going to do is generally they're going to want to come in and do the construction and permanent financing. For a multi-fund deal, typically what we're doing is we're raising equity generally all throughout the country, where we have a tendency to see more rural deals fit into those funds. And you know, that has some different parameters. And so as I look at each of their deals, I'm going to be scoping this out to say, does this look like something for a multi-fund, or does this look like something for a proprietary fund? Because the answer to that question will really kind of shake out in both the pricing and the terms and overall demand. So first, you know, I always look at you know, these deals as really a three-legged stool: sponsorship, structure, and then the real estate market itself. So as we kind of go through and look at this deal, one of the things I'd love to know is a little bit more about your development company. You had mentioned you do a lot of rural deals, and you've got one up here. So maybe you can give me a little background of, sure, you know, how many LIHTC deals in rural markets you've done. Do you kind of keep to Texas within a certain footprint, maybe a drivable distance, or do you are you all over the country?
We are all over the state of Texas. Okay, we collectively in the ownership and management leadership structure of the company have about 46 years worth of construction experience, over 20 of that or right about 20 of that in the specifically in tax credits. Mm-hmm. We have as far as tax credits development, we have like I said, one up in the Panhandle area, the town of Dalhart. Mm-hmm. We have two in kind of a deep East Texas, if you would consider that Deep East Texas, which is in a community known as Chandler. Mm-hmm. We have one in Gun Barrel City, just southeast of Dallas. We have one in Eustis. We have one in Fairfield as well. Mm-hmm. Now, those are both multifamily, a combination of multifamily and senior development. So okay, we do have experience across both of those. The smallest deal as far as the development itself is 49 units, the largest being 80.
Okay.
And then we have a kind of a scale in between that as well. All of our properties are flowing cash. We typically don't fall below the 90 to 93% in any occupancy issues that we have.
Okay.
And those that we do, it's usually either right at startup, because we like to occupy as we go during our construction.
Okay.
So instead of waiting until the projects, the development is completed and then start opening the gates and having people come in, we like to go ahead and get our COs on these buildings with the units in them so that we can start the cash flow going. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, because there'll be construction going on, and let's just say it's going to be a estimated 12-month period, start to finish, we may have a couple of units that will sit vacant for a couple of months while we're getting the construction finished, simply because people don't necessarily want to live in a construction zone, if you will,
sure.
sometimes. Other than that, it's your typical turnover time where someone gives notice. Mm-hmm. We have to wait till they move out so that we can turn it over, so we notify anybody that's on a waiting list. So there may be a 30-day, 60-day, something like that kind of period. I can tell you that, for example, in our gun barrel property, now that's a senior property, 80 mm-hmm. units. That's kind of our Cadillac, if you will, development. We have about a 2-year wait list right now.
That's great. For that. Out of curiosity, for gun barrel, what's the population?
The population of the town of Gun Barrel, you're mm-hmm. asking about? I believe that's about 7,000, is that right?
7,000.
I've got
okay.
help in the back over here.
Gotcha.
That's
okay.
part of my team. So about 7,000. This population for this deal that we're looking at here is about 2,500.
Right.
Just outside of Amarillo, so that's kind of a feeder or commuter town, if you mm-hmm. will. As far as the personalities within our organization, good news, I was just found not guilty. So
excellent.
Just kidding.
Yeah.
Our principal is he's been in this since '86. Mm-hmm. He has experience in the as a syndicator, as a lender, and as a developer. The other two owners, one of them has a lot of construction experience, especially in single family, high-end construction, mm-hmm. Custom homes. And then the other owner has a lot of project management experience, a lot of construction experience as well.
Okay.
So the three together really provide a well-balanced approach on making sure that we kind of cover our bases, make sure that we set our timelines and realistic time frames of getting things done, and we have a lot of resources available to us as well from that structure.
Gotcha. So, I mean, you sound like a pretty good experienced team, and one of the things that I like is when I see rural developers that are doing rural deals, what I get nervous is when folks are really one type of development and then go outside their wheelhouse. That's generally when we see some hiccups.
Sure.
So that's good to hear. One of the things you've touched on a little bit too is just your real estate schedule. And so as investors, what we like to do is take a look at your portfolio because it tells us a lot of different things. So we'll look at your real estate owned debt service coverages and cash flow. A, it tells us what your track record is in real data, right? Either you're successful or not. If it's cash flowing and doing well, so it sounds like that's doing well. It also alerts us to any potential dogs in your portfolio that could bring you down. One of the things that we learned in the downturn was, you'd be doing deals with people and everything was humming along fine. We'd look at our asset management reports and everything looked great. What we didn't know is that they had a condo deal or some other portfolio that was struggling. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, that was what brought some of these developers and general partners down. So we do spend a lot of time looking at kind of the overall, your portfolio, its health, and again, how that matches with what you're proposing to do.
Sure.
The other thing that we look at, too, when we look at your portfolio, when we go into the underwriting and when we look at the real estate itself, we'll underwrite the operating expenses. And we do like to take the developers' historical numbers. And so deals that are similar in similar markets, you know what you're doing, you know how to operate your own property. So we like to look at that as a data point. We will look at that against the appraisal. We'll look at that against some stuff in our portfolio. So we'll want to see that all of that flushes out. So as part of the process, we'd want to dive
Absolutely.
In a little bit on the REO. The other is, not that we have to get into specific numbers here, but we'll also want to look at, liquidity and net worth and making sure that it's commensurate with the size of the deal. So here on a deal like this, smaller, the operating deficit guarantee is probably pretty small. We'll size it accordingly. I won't get into specific numbers yet until we flush through all of the other questions. If I feel that there's some risk points here kind of above and beyond, we may want to require higher liquidity amounts just in case we feel that we need to reserve against something.
Sure.
You know, we've seen so much recently with difficulty on the general contractor side, A, just getting good contractors in, B, having their ability to maintain subs. And we see that really heightened in rural markets. It's just tough getting people out to some of these remote locations. Tell us a little bit about your experience there and how you've dealt with that.
Okay, so you're absolutely right that in rural areas it can be tough to get good labor force, I guess, mm-hmm. for the best way that I can explain that. One of the things that we do to combat that, let me back up just a little bit. One of the first things that the cities will ask us when we're at the city council meetings is, are you going to use local talent to help? Which we always say we will certainly provide the opportunity for that as long as they are qualified to do a project of this caliber.
Mm-hmm.
We do have our traveling circus, if you will, of certain trades that will go anywhere in the state that we send them. For example, like painters, framers. It's people is generally those trades, especially the framing trade, is where, I mean, there's lots of different levels of framers.
Mm-hmm.
But doing one that's multifamily that can get it done in a very time-constrained manner, we had enough exposure, I guess would be the term, to some different framing teams or companies,
mm-hmm.
That we've landed one that we've used that really balances out well. They give good work. They move fast and they're flexible. If the weather comes mm-hmm. in, they're not like, well, see you later. We're going to go up to Oklahoma because there's work up there, and we'll catch mm-hmm. you later. The other thing we do is that we actually go out to the largest community surrounding this rural area. Sometimes it can be 10 miles, sometimes it can be 30 miles, you know, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And we kind of exercise the pool out in that area because a lot of times if you have large enough construction trades or companies, they'll be willing to travel. You know, they'll have their comfortable threshold that they'll go to.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have any problem with going a little bit outside of the immediate area that we're trying to get the construction done. Negotiating reasonable rates and making sure really the full disclosures of their look, hey, you know, you're gonna have to travel, and that means that you may have to have your crew stay overnight at certain points. So we have plenty of experience with that, and unfortunately we have a little bit of experience of when we show up to work and suddenly the trade is not there,
mm-hmm.
and we call and say, where are you? Yeah, we decided this is not gonna work for us anymore. So we have a kind of a plan B type of people that we also usually kind of keep on the back burner,
mm-hmm.
That may not be able to just be as fast, but at least they can keep us moving until we can, you know, repair the leak, if you will.
Gotcha. No, great. Thank you. And again, it's one of the biggest problems we've seen in the last,
sure.
really couple of years. And what does that mean? That means, you know, cost goes up and, you know, timing delays. And when costs go up, there's a hole in the numbers, and timing delay means the investors don't get their credits when they expected them to, which means you get an adjuster, which isn't good for anybody, right? So, which again, you know, creates a hole in the sources and uses. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about your experience and who you guys are. I think I did my first tax credit deal like 23 years ago, and I know Mike Chagrou was around then and was probably involved in somehow or some way. So I've got a very strong, positive impression of your group. So just I want to make sure, though, who am I actually dealing with in terms of the guarantors and the partnership? So, you know, Chris talked about the various entities, and for the audience, you know, who the general partner is, who the developer is. So as we talk to, you know, Chris and Ben about their companies, we're getting excited. We're looking at these people that have been around for a while. And so we just want to make sure on paper, we really are getting those guarantors.
Absolutely.
So are you doing corporate guarantees? Are you doing personal guarantees? What is the company that's actually doing the development?
And that's going to be same people that you're talking to on the phone, mm-hmm. same people. That's going to be the Mike Shagru and the Victoria mm-hmm. Shagru and me,
okay.
Ben Dempsey as well.
Great.
So yeah, we're not just putting our name on it and then bringing in somebody else to get it done while we're vacationing in the Bahamas.
Great.
So that does sound kind of nice, but that's
great,
not
great.
What we're
great.
Still a small family owned, and we like to keep it lean and mean.
Excellent. So, again, in the investor community, in the perfect world, we always love to have individual investors, the large corporation that's really kind of behind, the true development company. And the longer those guarantees, the happier that we all are. And for the developer, naturally, the shorter that period of time for the guarantees, the better. It's one of the things that's kind of unique to the tax credit world is once you get that credit allocation and once you close, the risk really shifts dramatically. And so the investors coming in and buying those credits, their equity's coming in chunks. Your construction lender's putting their money in chunks. And at that point in time, the developer doesn't have any cash in it other than the developer fee, which could become opportunity cost. At that point in time, all your closing and pursuit costs are out. So really, what's at risk at that point for the developer is the developer fee and their reputation. And so the folks that we've seen around the business a long time, they guard that reputation with everything, whether that means they're going to have to lose some developer fee at some point in time. And so what you'll see is the investor and the lenders look at this, they're looking at it with a very skeptical lens. And so, because ultimately, if something happens to the developer, we have to step in and fix it. And so as we're evaluating risk here, that's what really comes into play. That's what we're thinking in our minds. So as we look at, the difference between a large 4% deal with lots of debt and a rural deal, we may perceive a rural deal to be a little bit riskier on the market rate side, but I can probably step in and fix, a problem with the permanent mortgage if I had to downsize it 10%. I probably couldn't downsize yours by 10% without really inflicting some pain. So just one of the things to kind of keep in mind as we go through. So I've got a good sense of the development team and the sponsorship, and we really like what we see. So tell us a little bit about the structure. Rural markets make us very nervous, especially when they're just, size of 2,500. We'll dive into a little bit more about the specifics of the real estate, but many rural deals we'll see with either, soft loans or like a TDHCA home loan, which we like. Mm-hmm. It's generally below market rate. And just having TDHCA involved is kind of nice because we just don't foresee TDHCA foreclosing on a tax credit deal. Mm-hmm. So can you tell us a little bit about the debt structure and what your thoughts were?
Well, the way that you what we have up here right now, we've made it work without doing having to go into home loan. Now, that's not to say that if it made you more comfortable that we couldn't structure that up with home loan. That's not a problem. We've even recently done two deals on 538. Mm-hmm. Well, he's not even here anymore. Chris was here with Bonneville, and again, that's something that we're not against doing. If it would help for a better comfort level of what's there. But we try to structure it without it if possible. That's just our kind of our business model. But we're not 100% against it either. With the way that we've set this up, our deferred developer fee is primarily just during the construction period, with very minimal during the rolling over permanent to the permanent finance okay. side. We've got enough. Contingency, if you will, kind of talking a little bit about what you were saying earlier. If we start kind of redlining in certain areas, that we can adjust, if you mm-hmm. will. But really, at the end of the day, to answer your question, I mean, we're open that if you would if your company is like, well, we really would like to see more of a something like a home structure built into this. That's not a showstopper for us.
Okay. All right, great. And again, rural communities, we typically will see like either some sort of TDHCA home or like the 538 quite a bit, or some folks that kind of specialize in more rural markets, which will be great. So reserves, we really like to see 6 months of operating expenses and debt service funded. by the time we hit permanent loan closing.
Sure.
So we're going to have that in the deal?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, that's not a problem.
Do you have a lease-up reserve in there at all?
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
Yeah, that'll be in there as well. That's,
okay.
Did I send you all the big
ones? You know, I don't know if I had the I think just the rents, but...
Oh, sorry. That was supposed to be in there.
Oh, okay. And then, so reserves are good. In terms of, construction lender, are you open to using whoever in the event that we want to pursue some sort of proprietary?
You're saying who you would suggest? I'm not going to say no, that we're not open to it. We're always open to it. We do have a couple of established relationships with people that we're comfortable with, that they're comfortable with us.
Mm-hmm.
That could, if we sat down and talked about it, you could find out it's the same people. I don't know.
Sure.
So to answer your question, no, we're not against exercising the option of going with a preferred partnering mm-hmm. with a whoever your preferred lender or lending institution might be.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, these numbers that we've put on there mm-hmm. Have actually come from one of our preferred lenders. But mm-hmm. yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say no to that.
No. So, all right. So it's kind of it's almost like a trick question, right? So, you know, we sometimes have these folks that want to come in and pay a little bit more in the equity, but they want the debt. But we also like it when developers have got, you know, kind of deep relationships and people that they've done a lot of business with. We like loyalty. We enjoy loyalty ourselves. And so keeping the same development team together, generally we see less problems happen, right? Stuff's going to pop up on deals, and it's nice when it's somebody that you're working with that you've worked with all the time.
Sure.
To get through it. So I like that, actually. I think that's great. And honestly, it's probably someone that we've worked with anyways.
It is. It is.
Gotcha. No, I got to tell you, honestly, for Panhandle, Texas, I'm just going to go ahead and say it. There's probably not a lot of CRA value here. So we'd be looking at this for a multi-fund. So the good thing is you can pretty much pick whatever lender you want.
Sure.
All right, great. So, we've got new construction, seniors. Is this a similar product to what you've built before?
Oh, yeah. As far as the, like, I can even, like, to the architectural structure that we have in mind is pretty much a model that we've used before, or a combination of some different models that we've used. And what I mean by that is, with the detached clubhouse, with the some fourplexes, and I think we'd have one eightplex on that property. I don't have the site plan in front of me.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a rendering of what we've already produced in the past at other properties.
It's a product that works, and then we love to see
Absolutely.
That. So that's
we've
great.
We've already worked the kinks out of that one.
All right, so. Good. And then do you do modular, or is this kind of stick build?
It's a stick frame. Yep.
Okay. All right, great. And then in terms of kind of cost per unit, hard cost, what are you looking at for this market?
I believe we were just under $70, or $69 a square foot. What we were looking at.
Okay. All right, good. So again, we talked, it's a very straightforward structure with this, and that is one of the benefits of rural deals. Very simple, typically just, construction loan, permanent loan, equity, which is great. Less issues, less cooks in the kitchen, so to speak. So we've talked a little bit about sponsorship structure, and now let's dive into the real estate. And this is always really the fun part and what makes it always interesting, right? Every piece of dirt's different. Every market's different. The site itself looked very straightforward, right? You're kind of on the edge of town.
Right.
Any particular issues? I didn't see any power lines or do you have any gas and oil easements that go through the site?
No, this is actually what we call a straight shooter site. Mm-hmm. Where it is in the site development or the site aerial that I was showing earlier, it butts right up to the edge of town. There's actually a senior community center that's kind of in the corner pocket of that space. So as far as tying in for your utilities, for your power,
mm-hmm.
it's we have several different areas that we could come in and tie in with. It's a relatively flat piece of land, so we don't have a lot of bad runoff type mm-hmm. issues that we're going to be looking at. Power lines, we don't have any high power lines, high tension power lines that are going through
gotcha.
It. There's not a railroad track that's going to be going right through the middle of it.
No turtles, spotted owls, right? It's all good.
None that we're going to admit. So,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Gotcha. I actually had a deal in Utah in which the site was here and right over here was dinosaur tracks, and it was like literally starting to lead right up to the site. and they had to stop to determine if, in fact, because this was like a national monument, the dinosaur tracks, if it made it to the site or not. Fortunately, the dinosaur must have just turned and chased something else. Like, or my client got out there with a you know jackhammer and got him out before they got there. So,
what do
you
mean if the dinosaur didn't like the site?
Yeah, yeah, it went running, I guess. But so all kinds of things happen with the sites, and especially here in Texas. I mean, it's amazing just the gas and oil utility easements, all that kind of stuff. Keeps us really busy. Surrounding uses, you talked a little bit about, you know, again, mostly single family. I like the senior center there, which is great. I think dovetails very well with this. Tell me, I think the biggest thing for me, just looking at a town with 2,500, and there's nothing really kind of around it for a little while. You got Pampa kind of to the northeast, and then you've got Amarillo. Kind of, what is the largest employer here? Kind of, what are the folks doing here?
Well, there's several. Like I said, it's actually a bedroom community for Amarillo, so that opens it wide open. There's wind farms that and agricultural and the oil and gas as well that people will go out and get their employment from there. Of course, you've also got the independent school district, which is always one of your largest employers in the rural areas. The one thing I can tell you about the town of Panhandle, we actually didn't go to them technically. They came to us and said, hey, we have a huge demand. Mm-hmm. People are, our phone is ringing all the time at City Hall. We need affordable housing because people don't want to live in Amarillo even because they go work there. I mean, it's rural Texas, so they're willing to drive 30, 35 miles to go to work. That's not the problem. So they want to come out to this area, to the town of Panhandle. And the biggest thing is the schools are huge there, as far as, not huge as in larger size, but I mean in their scoring and how well they do. It's a country atmosphere, and that's what a lot of people want to retire. Or there are people who have grown up in that general area, maybe in White Deer, which is just a little bit to the east. They want to come back to that area to retire, or even Amarillo. They're tired of the that kind of life. They want to come back and retire, in Panhandle, in the town of Panhandle.
Gotcha. And thanks. You answered one of my questions, and that is I love it when you have that interaction where a town is kind of looking for affordable housing versus, as you said earlier, someone's just kind of point chasing and saying, hey, I can go get credits here because it's easier. So we really like to see that, the town's behind it. And then the other thing is, too, is demand. And so what I worry about with just a 60-unit deal in a town of 2,500, especially with seniors, is I'm sure we're going to see pretty high capture and penetration rates. And so what we look at is, demographics within. We try to define where the market area is. And then from there, how many income-eligible renters are actually there? And with seniors, we find that we do attract from a wider band. It's funny, ironically enough, whenever we do these in Houston, we always come up with extremely high capture and penetration rates. It's crazy. But they come from all over the place. And rural, same thing. They'll travel further if they know that there's housing there. So a lot of it is, I think, again, to your background, is knowing who to talk to, getting the word out that seniors deal is there, and they'll come. But again, when we see high capture and penetration rates, which I haven't seen the market study, but I can just go ahead and guess that they're probably pretty high. What that means, again, is maybe a slow lease-up, which means timing issues, delays on credits, adjusters, a hit to sources, or you can't get the rents. We see that quite a bit as well. So again, that sizes your per mortgage that needs to be downsized, and we lose sources to the deal again to finish it. So the other thing that we see with rural markets that can be difficult is, do we have any true comps, right? So all of us want to look and say, we want a 10% advantage to market. It's sometimes hard in a market like this. I bet you're probably going to be the newest thing that's ever happened there in like 30 years.
Sure.
So what is the market for that? There's no other LIHTC senior deal right there in the market to say, hey, in this community, this is what these rents go for. So I'm going to suspect that the market study guy went out and said, well, hey, I'm going to go up to Pampa, and I'm going to go up to Amarillo. And Amarillo really is a different market. But they're probably going to size those market rents to those comps in Amarillo. And so a little bit of it is going to be, as we perceive, more market risk, because it really is going to be one of those, hey, if they build it, they will come. And so, you know, if I were to look at this deal with a, you know, first-time tax credit developer or an urban developer that just kind of flew in from out of state, it'd be very tough for us. I think given that you're experienced in doing affordable rural deals and these types of communities, we'd certainly want to, you know, continue and move forward. What we may look to do is just we're going to conservatively underwrite the rents and expenses. Maybe we want to have a slower lease up. You know, maybe you come in and say, hey, it's cool. We're going to lease this thing up in like 2 months. We may say, geez, when we get our market study, it really says it's going to take you, you know, 8. And so we just want to bake that into the time frame for that credit delivery. So, you know, and again, looking at that, that's where that, you know, if you had a TDHC, a home loan, it gives us a little bit more comfort so that it's like we're not over leveraged, because that's our biggest concern is we get over leveraged and we can't support the debt.
Well, and one of the things that we did on our rent schedule, I'm not going to say we stressed the deal, but we did, we kind of lowered down our rents to help with making sure that we can get them rented up a little bit faster. So we kind of did our own, you know, internal, if you will, stress testing, for lack of a better term, to try to address exactly that issue. Now, you can't ever take. Let me say this right. The city representatives have told us, and I know they're just city representatives. They could say anything they want. But they've told us specifically for this deal that they basically already got a waiting list for us because
Great.
That's how excited the community is for what we're bringing, specifically because it's a senior deal.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a lot easier for them. Now, does that mean that they went out and re-qualified them?
Right,
no.
Right.
You know, it's things that give us a little bit more comfort. And I'm going to say, at the end of the day, if this was just a foul odor on this deal, you know, on this development, we don't even want to touch it because especially in the rural markets, you've got to have you've got to have a straight shooter or as close a straight shooter as you can get, because you know your cash flow is already going to be, you're going to have enough to cover your expenses, have a little bit left over, or whatever, but you don't want to feed the deal from day one, and that's the one thing that we try to make sure. And we actually have a very good record of that. We're not feeding any of our properties, minus the initial lease up time that you may have or whatever.
That's fantastic.
But as far as after our final cutting of the ribbon, if you will, when we're grand opening and all that, we don't feed our properties because we partner with a property management company that's real good with their marketing. We provide our own ideas and theories in that as well. So we stand on our track record with that, I would say, ahead of time and then after the fact.
Great. And then for Section 8 rents, that's the other thing that we'll look at too, is when we look at rural markets, it's in the event that you miss on where your pro forma rents are, is at least the Section 8 rents enough to cover kind of your pro forma? Are they above or below?
As far as they are, they're actually above what we posted.
Fantastic. So many times we see them go the other way. And so in theory is if the market isn't as deep as you think it's going to be, in the investor's mind, it's like, well, could you move Section 8 in? A, are the Section 8 rents enough to cover that rent? And then B, are there actually enough Section 8 vouchers in that particular market? Because there are some markets where we say, hey, great, you know, we can always fill it with Section 8, but
right, and that's just not enough there. We kind of lowered them from what the max rents are. Now, if we had gone all straight max rents, we couldn't say that. But, you know, we brought it down and we're still able to, you know, to still make it balance.
Gotcha. So, in summary, rural deals we always perceive as just a little bit riskier from the market rate side and from an operational standpoint, just because they never go like this. It's, you know, they kind of just flat. AMIs might trend flat. Expenses never go down. They always just go up. So you have a situation where they might just kind of teeter along. But you've got an experienced development team. I like that you use the same property management company. You've got a good plan around the general contractors and kind of consistent. This is your market. This is what you guys do. So we'd certainly love to be an investor in the deal. You know, as I mentioned, we'd be funding this probably for a multi-fund. I think multi-funds have pretty much hit their bottom. And if you all come to the equity panel tomorrow, we can give you more of a highlight there, just a little plug. But so we do see it ticking up a little bit, but you know, current market in a multi-fund right now would be kind of the low dollars, like $1, $2, maybe $3, just depending on how quickly the equity came in.
Sure.
We do think that's going to trend down a little bit, not dramatically, you know, maybe a penny here or two. We do see multi-fund pricing kind of hitting a stopping point at a 5 yield. And below that's really where you start seeing that $2, $3. So it might be closer to $1.
Okay.
Again, we'd size reserves to 6 and 6, maybe a little bit longer lease-up reserve. But the fact is, if we don't use a lease-up reserve, we're happy to release that to you as cash flow, which goes to pay deferred fee and incentive management fees, things like that. We are going to, you know, look to your expenses and all that and really, really scrub the operating expenses and the rents. The other thing we'll look at is, you know, the employers in town, and that's part of our due diligence. You know, we did a deal up in Plainview in which, you know, when we went in for the application, everything was really good. By the time we got the credit allocation, we're ready to work on the deal. Cargill closed its plant, which employed 5,000 people in a town of, you know, 12,000. So it's pretty significant. So those are the types of things that we'd look at. But we'd absolutely love to for a chance to do the deal with you.
That sounds good. As you see, we had the syndication rate set at 92 cents. So
all right.
I'm not complaining.
There you go.
Take it.
Take the money and run.
Sold. Deal.
All right. Good. How are we doing? How are we doing on time? Is it okay on time? Diane, are we doing good on time?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Oh, okay. I'm really going to grill them then.
Since we have an hour, I'll take a lot of time. So, I'm never say no Ackberry, and he's not the yes man, Kearse. So, the deal we're talking about today is an urban 4% tax credit project here in Austin. It's approximately 3 acres. Currently, the site is zoned where we can be able to build multifamily on it. But we're actually proposing that with the density bonus for affordable housing, we're going to actually add about 72 units more. So we're going to have to go through a rezone to get those additional units added to the project. As you can see, the project is made up of a combination of efficiencies, one-bedroom units, two-bedroom units, three-bedroom, and four. And the top portion of them, those are all flat-style units, and those are, for the most part, in the larger buildings that are on the north side of the site. And then we have 12 townhome units. On this side of the site, we have a neighborhood, and we wanted to try to bring the housing units down to the neighborhood so that there wasn't this big variance between heights and density between the neighborhood and our project. So it's 246 units total. Out of the project, we're proposing that we'll have 38 of the 246 units will be market rate. 208 of them will be affordable housing. Out of the affordable housing units, we're going to make 10% of them at 30% AMI, and the rest of them will be at 60% AMI. We have underwritten it at the max 60s, and we have underwritten our market rents at the market. So the market right now, the difference between the market rents and the max 60 rents is about 20-25% difference. So there's a pretty big variance between my market rents and my affordable rents. The gross monthly income generated once it's stabilized in year two and a half is $235,286. My effective income at a 7.5% vacancy with you know, some other other income and other things like that is about $217,639. Effective annual gross rent of $2.6 million. What we are getting for this site is actually an ad valorem tax exemption, and we're working with Travis County and Travis County Housing Finance Corporation, or possibly Austin Housing Finance Corporation, to work with us to get a tax exemption. Our plan is to use the lack of paying ad valorem taxes to lower our expenses, which will help us leverage the project up to cover some of the gap in financing. So our operating expenses are right at $1,042,000. That's a 39.92% expense to income ratio, which is in range for bond deals right now, especially with this number of units. So our NOI is about $1,569,000, and we're proposing that with our permanent loans, our debt service will be $1,003,000, and that's a debt service coverage ratio of 1.2 times. It would have a net cash flow of about $266,000 a year. So we put here the permanent sources of uses, sources and uses for the project. But one thing that was not noted here is that we're going to issue out about $30 million in bonds. The bonds will be issued by a local issuer who hopefully will be part of the ownership in the deal. With that, we should be able to generate enough funds that we can be able to slow down the timing of your equity, because we are asking for you to actually put in like $1.10 for the project. The way that the deal is structured right now, you can see that our 112% of our developer fee is deferred at this point in time. And the reason why is because we found out that we have some issues on the site that relate to a dry cleaner that was on the northwest side of the property. And that is actually leaked into the soil. And so we're going to have some mitigation factors for that. And so we know because of that, our construction costs have gone up. We also, at the site, there is a an existing building which we have to demo, and that is included in our construction cost. We at this time, in order to try to get the deferred developer fee down, we are actually trying to see if we can get some local soft funds to reduce that. The other thing is that we feel like it's feasible that maybe we could be able to add some additional debt. So right now we're conservatively using a 5% interest rate, but we think that with the Freddie Mac tax-exempt loan structure, we maybe could be able to get like a 4.2% interest rate. If we did that, that would obviously increase our permanent debt. Right now, we feel like we're not really that highly leveraged because we're only at like $80,000 a door in debt. And as you know, in Austin and major metro areas, debt per door is getting close to $100,000
right.
a unit. So. Other than that, we have reserves built into the deal. We have about a $240,000 lease-up reserve, and we have 6 months of operating expenses and debt service payments included in our operating reserve.
Great. Fantastic. There's definitely a lot here. And, you know, for the audience, it's like, you know, it's great to see these two deals contrasted, right? So from a risk standpoint, you know, the market in Austin's been very, very strong, and I'm not really sure where the location is for this. Is this
In East Austin.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, gotcha. But it's a big project, and you look at the amount of debt. So if we're starting out with, you know, $22 million in hard debt versus Ben's deal that only had $2 million in debt, what we like to do as investors is hold the cash developer fee, and we have these things called minimum holdbacks. You may have heard of these. So we don't give you your developer fee all right away. We try to give you a portion at close, and then what we like to do is hold a portion back until CO, which we kind of consider almost extra contingency. And then we hold a portion back until stabilization, you convert to your perm. And that amount we like to size to 10% of the permanent mortgage. And what we do with that is we're in our minds is, hey, listen, if you miss on your rents or your expenses and we got to downsize the permanent mortgage when it comes time to hit stabilization, that we've got some funds there in the event that you can't write a check. And then we typically hold the last stub for until 8609s, and that we try to equate to about 3 months of tax credits. And that's for any potential timing adjusters. So on a deal this size, you know, we'd probably want to hold, you know, in the perfect world, we'd be holding like $2.2 million of your cash developer fee for stabilization, you know, probably another like $400,000 for 8609s. And then, you know, ideally, you know, a contingency amount, which is probably going to be like $600,000-$700,000. So if I looked at this deal in my perfect world, there'd be like $3 or $4 million of cash developer fee to hold. And right now you've got negative cash developer fee.
Well, we're going to actually get some funds from the city of Austin. So we would be okay if you paid $2.2 million at closing for the developer fee.
And also, Chris, to kind of perhaps make some additional room in the budget that may allow some fee to be paid, you might maybe consider trying to implement a sales tax exemption structure, since you do have the government authority and the deal that's going to be providing the ground lease of the land for the tax credits. Perhaps they have an exempt entity that they could also use that will enter in, that will be able to enter into the construction contract with the owner, and then that contract gets subcontracted to your actual builder. So you're basically going to put a layer of a contractor into the structure where the exempt entity on paper acts as a general contractor, and that will allow you to also have some sales tax exemption on the materials, and maybe that'll help to make some room in your budget.
Mm-hmm. She just found us $1.2 million.
I like that. I like that.
One other thing to point out was depending on how much of the developer fee you end up deferring, you know, the amount of cash flow, I'd be really careful to make sure that you have enough cash flow to pay off that developer fee by year 15. There is a potential that, one, if you haven't paid off your developer fee, there might be phantom income for the general partner at the end, and two, the state agencies might come and look at it and saying, if you never penciled out the deal to pay off the developer fee by the end of year 15, that potentially wouldn't even be able to go into eligible basis, which is kind of the starting point of claiming your tax credits. So you could have potentially an issue there.
Right. No, absolutely. And again, without those additional sources, it would be tough. I mean, it looks like a really neat project, but you know, if you did get the City of Austin funds, if you were able to get some, you know, savings on the sales tax exemption, the real estate tax exemption, get the debt up a little bit, it definitely helps. So the other thing that we'd probably spend a lot of time on is those rents. And it sounds like, you know, to have your rents up at 60% median income is probably fine in this market, given that you get the rent advantage. Even on market rents, we do like to see a 10% advantage on the market for the market rents. In the perfect world, we do make exceptions, and sometimes, you know, we might go down to 5, but underwriting them at the market definitely is a riskier proposition for us of, again, being potentially over leveraged.
So we would need to bring the rents down to about 10% or so above the LIHTC rents?
If we determine, so you mentioned that the market rents are about 25% higher than the 60% rents.
Yes.
So we'd want to cut those market rents, you know, 10%. And so you've only got, well, you've got 38 of them, but they probably make a pretty decent portion of the revenue stream.
Yeah.
And again, the reason why is, you know, so many investors, you know, some are real estate focused, some are not. And you'd be surprised how many are not. A lot of the people that make the decisions on investing in tax credits, they're not real estate guys. Some of them aren't even commercial lenders. They're tax guys that sit in an office in New York somewhere and wouldn't know a tax credit if it bit them in the butt. So what they're looking at is just that stream. They see it like a treasury where it's very safe. And so when you have a huge rent advantage, when you see that you're way below market, everything's pretty solid, low leverage, they know that they're gonna get those credits from year to year. If you have higher leverage, then there's that higher probability that this could go into foreclosure at a later point in time. And kind of like I was making that point before, you know, 10% of your permanent mortgage is gonna be almost $3 million by the time we're done with it. And so if you couldn't write the check, let's just say you built it, we got into lease up, and you couldn't get the rents. You know, the market dipped. You know, there's too much overbuilding in Austin. There has been a lot of tax credit deals built in Austin recently. What happens if the market dips? And I had this happen back in the dot-com bubble, in which we underwrote a bunch of deals to 60% median income. And lo and behold, they dropped down to the 50% levels. And their tax credit deals were actually competing with market rate deals. It was crazy. But in the event that those rents come down, you know, if you would have to resize that mortgage. And so, you know, again, looking to that sponsor, you know, we'd want to look at we'd really want to see a much higher net worth and liquidity here. Because if you had to write a check, it's going to be a big check. And if you can't write a check and we have to remove you to protect our credits, we got to write a big check. And so that's why, this one would.
So on a deal of this size with $30 million in bonds, what do you think your liquidity and net worth requirements would be?
You know, it's funny because earlier I was saying I don't think it would be that bad, but if we get really comfortable with the underwriting, if we really buy into the rents, the expenses, the construction costs, $2 to $3 million liquid would probably be what we'd want to see. Net worth, it'd be great if it's over 10 million, 15 million. Okay. Because again, we have seen this in the past where sometimes there are misses. And on high density projects like this, there can be a higher propensity for cost overruns. You know, just issues that happen along the way. A little bit more, it's more complicated than just, you know, kind of stick build garden style.
Absolutely.
So kind of going back to like what we were talking about before and kind of diving in a little bit on sponsorship, you know, have you done a lot of these types of kind of, you know, large urban projects, a lot of concrete, a lot of footings?
Yeah, so we've done a total of 27 9% deals. We've done 10 bond deals in the state of Texas, and we currently are working on two projects of a similar nature. We've completed one project that has high density parking garage, stick built. Mm-hmm. This is actually a metal stud frame built. Mm-hmm. This will be the first time that we've done metal stud frame construction, but we're certain with the difficulty to find, you know, framers right now, it'll be easier to find metal stud framers than wood framers. So.
Gotcha. Great. And then for those other deals that you've done in real estate schedule, I mean, how does that look? Are those all doing really well, cash flowing?
Yeah, so all of our properties are doing well. We have two of them that have occupancy troubles, sometimes because of the new build units in the market. They've dropped down to like 84-85% occupancy, but they've still paid their debt service. And we have no properties that have not made all of their covenants. Mm-hmm. They've all been placed in service. We've never had a deal that didn't get delivered. So our REO schedule, while it has some occupancy issues, is pretty solid.
Great. Oh, question in the back.
So what is the density per acre and what is the zoning classification? How does that compare with other surrounding areas?
I can't do the math very quickly, but 246, I guess it's about 80 units per acre. Most of the stuff that's around there is pretty much not this dense, but to the north and to the west, there are some dense areas where there's office buildings that are being built, other high-rise market apartments that are going in that are at the top of the, market, so AAA, Class A. So.
Oh, question?
With respect to the NIMBY issue, does it help to have affordable and market rate mixed in together?
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm. A lot of times they want to see multiple income levels. Like, they don't want to see all 30 or 50% incomes. They want to be able to see that that you're serving a large population. And for us, we like to have market units because if you have an issue where, just an example, there was a mistake that was made in the calculation of the person's income, you have a way to be able to move them in your development without having really major issues. Of course, you have to work harder to resolve any compliance issues, but it gives you options. So.
Great. And so I know that you've got an award-winning attorney working on this project, and maybe they could talk us through a little bit of the structure with the Housing Finance Corp and how that real estate tax thing's going to work.
Okay.
Okay. So you mentioned before, Chris, that you're planning to use the ground lease structure, correct?
Yes, I am.
Okay. And so which government entity is it with again? Remind me.
I think it'll probably be with Austin Housing Finance Corporation.
Okay. So the intent is that they will acquire the land, and then they'll enter into a ground lease with your project owner to build the housing. And so the expectation also would be that the HFC will be the general partner in your owner, correct?
Yes, and then we would be the special limited partner in the project.
Okay, good. I wanted to be sure that you had considered that, because with the guarantees that you're still going to be responsible for, you want to be sure that you ultimately still have some consent and oversight over what the general partner's doing to try to protect your guarantees.
Okay. Yeah, our plan was is that they would be 0.01% and we would be 0.01%. And whatever consents that are necessary, I'm sure we could build that into the deal.
Okay.
All right, great. And while we're on legal, how's the title and survey looking? I mean, you know, some of these infill sites we see, you know, we end up spending probably a lot on legal fees ourselves just looking into all the...
Yeah, so really the site has clear title and survey. The problem is that there's an easement on the backside of the site mm-hmm. that we're trying to get negotiated. The easement actually runs along the townhome portion, and what that might make us do is actually set back the unit some.
Okay.
But we think we're going to be okay with that.
All right, great.
It may just take a little bit of time. If you're not familiar with the city of Austin, it does seem to take
a little bit of time.
A little, somewhere around 6 to 10 years to get anything
gotcha.
Done.
Gotcha. You know, yeah. So, you know, and that is one of the things, too, and again, kind of comparing and contrasting the two deals. 9% deal, once you get that allocation, you really have a gun to your head in terms of timing. The 4%, you know, you take down your volume cap, you do have a time frame, but there's so much volume cap available that you can return it, get a new issuance of volume cap, so you do have a little bit more time to work through these things. So one of the things we always like to try to ferret out soon, too, is just, you know, to your point earlier, you know, how long do you have the land out there? You know, are there any other guns to your head in terms of timing? So, for instance, you might have that site negotiated to be out for a while you work through that exception. But if the city of Austin comes in and says, hey, by the way, guess what? It's your lucky day. We just had $4 million returned on another deal, but we have to have it out in the next 6 months. You know, so those are the things that we kind of see pop up on these types of deals quite a bit. So, you know, any timing issues at all right now that you're aware of?
The only thing is we, you know, we have an actual allocation of bonds that we have a 3-year timeline on.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's no problems with that. I think mostly what it'll just be is, you know, us wanting to move the project to closing a little faster before mm-hmm. the market really shifts or the equity changes. So.
Yeah, great. And again, if you go FHA or, you know, it's just, you know, in the event that you do look at that route, you know, that does add a lot of time to your project. We've seen a few deals die on the vine because of that, just, you know, just the amount of time it takes to get through that process. And there are some folks out there doing some balance sheet product that, you know, goes a little quicker. You may leave some proceeds on the table, but it gets your deal done fast.
Well, we've decided that we're only going to use a major bank. So,
yeah.
You know, we'll probably use Citibank or Bank of America or someone like that.
All right, great. Great. And so as I look at this type of deal for investors, okay, so kind of going back to before, do we look at it for a multi-fund? Do we look at it for a proprietary investor? The funny thing about bond deals are, so your typical proprietary investor would say, hey, you know, you want $1.09 or $1.10 on this, and that's actually not out of market for a high profile, high density deal like this. You know, however, that normally comes with a very low yield, and so typically they'd want to do the debt. In a bond deal, they can't do that. They can't hold the debt as well as the equity, otherwise it collapses the tax-exempt nature of the bonds. And so what we have to do is look at it a couple different ways. You know, one, are they just going to be holding the bonds short-term for the construction period? So if that's the case, then what we can do is, you know, RBC can hold the equity until we get to basically, you know, completion and conversion perm, and then put it to the investor. And naturally, you know, we're gonna factor that into the yield because we're taking on more risk. Or can we put it into a fund and have them only buy 49% of it, and we take 51% of it if we were to do it proprietary? Or do we just try to put it into a multi-fund and again, making sure that they don't have a preponderance of the ownership structure? So it makes it more difficult because, you know, someone might come in like a Citibank and say, hey, we'd like to buy the equity too. We'd really have to work through the structure on that. And so, you know, going back to, you know, as you're selecting your syndicator and partners and working through that, not all syndicators are created equal. And that's why some of us with balance sheets have the ability to work through these types of structures and be a little bit more flexibility to hold that long term or to work out something with one of these large banks. So just something to keep in consideration. So as we approach this deal, I would think that we'd have a few investors interested. Austin is, surprisingly for being the state's capital, it has good CRA, but it's not the same as like Dallas and Houston. Dallas and Houston, we can't buy enough tax credit deals there. Austin's funny because someone will come in, they'll buy a bunch of deals, and then all of a sudden they're done. You know, we had a few of the local banks that kind of really got involved, bought heavy, and then they sat out the next 2 years. So as we'd approach this, I'd probably most likely end up putting this into a multi-fund. So what's interesting is I'd be putting your deal in the same fund with his deal, but the pricing would be very different. Your deal profiles very differently, so it actually, there's a lot of losses involved. There is a smaller amount of equity for the amount of depreciation that's going on within the deal. So just by that nature, your pricing is going to be higher because our yield is going to be higher. We may also have someone that does need Austin, whereas they may not need, you know, Panhandle, Texas, no offense. So the guy that's going to buy Panhandle is probably just a yield buyer, maybe not even a bank. So that they're going to buy at the higher end of the yield perspective. And yours, we can probably get a bank that says, hey, I really do need that CRA and give us a little bit better yield. And we can sell it in the same fund. But now what we've been doing is we're tiering these funds so that we can actually sell different yields within the fund. So that if I've got an insurance company that says, I just need generic tax credits, I can sell them Panhandle at a 5. But if I've got a large bank that says, hey, we'd like your fund, and you know what, we really like that Austin project that ITEX is doing, and we'll pay up for that. I can get them to pay a 450, which then allows me to pay 50 basis points more of equity toward your deal, and that could equate to, you know, anywhere from 3 to 5 cents. Yep.
Can you or Mike explain why an investor would pay over a dollar for a dollar?
It makes absolutely no sense, and I can't explain it to you. Seriously.
A lot of it is CRA driven,
right?
And so there has been studies that have been done about looking at these major markets like your Austins, your Houstons, Dallas, and you look at kind of what the competition is for the CRA credits, and there's a one-to-one correlation between the demand of that and the credit pricing.
Right.
And so that's part of it.
Right. And, you know, there's a yield there, and it doesn't make sense to pay a dollar for something. It's almost like buying a coupon, right? You know, it's like, hey, give me a dollar, and I'll give you a dollar off, you know, the purchase of this item. But there is a yield in there. And so, you know, when you look at pricing has been the highest it's ever been in the history of the tax credit program. But it is. It's driven by CRA. So there's an intrinsic value there for that Community Reinvestment Act. You know, these banks get rated as to how well they're doing investing in their communities. And that's a huge piece of it, because they also get a return. And that return is small. And when you even paying a, you know, $1.10, you can still get a return off of that because you're getting depreciation and losses and all those things that kind of filter into that rate of return. And you can also take a deal like that and blend it with others that maybe have a higher yield so that you're within a fund, you're getting still a yield. And even though that yield's low, it's still higher than a 10-year treasury. And that's what these folks are looking at. They're saying, hey, wait a second. I can reinvest in my community. I score points with CRA, right? So I can make sure that, you know, as a bank, I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. The Fed's not going to crack down on me. And I'm also getting a return. And the smart ones are saying, hey, on top of that, not only am I going to give you my equity at that $1.09 pricing, but I want the construction loan too, which I'm going to make money on. And I'm going to get the permanent loan, which I'm going to make money on, and I'm probably going to have you open some checking accounts for all your operating reserves. So they've been smart about, you know, making sure that they're leveraging their dollars. And the CRA stuff, it really is important. So, you know, there's been a couple bank mergers that actually got held up because they had a low CRA ranking.
Right, and those CRA rankings, I mean, they, mm-hmm. they happen every 3 years.
Right.
And so depending on what bank is in what cycle, mm-hmm. like when you mentioned that right. in Austin, you're like, oh, you know, it'll be a demand and then 2 years would go by, nothing happens.
Right.
Well, it's probably because everybody's on that,
exactly.
on that same 3 year cycle.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, imagine when year two comes, all of a sudden they wake up and mm-hmm. say, oh my gosh, right. I have to invest in Austin. I need to play it right now.
Right.
And that'll drive up the credit pricing quite a bit.
Yeah, absolutely. And we just saw that, you know, so we'll leave the banks unnamed. But, you know, one bank, it's like their CRA rating was actually very poor and they really needed to get dollars out the door right away. And someone happened to have a few deals and they paid probably 4 or 5 cents above the market for them. You know, the reason why we're seeing such high pricing in Dallas and Houston is because you've got so many banks that have such demand there. You know, supply doesn't meet demand. These guys have got to get that CRA there. And so what our goal is to try to, you know, factor all these different, you know, dynamics in to get Chris and Ben the highest price for their deals at any given point in time. And it's kind of like that, you know, never stepping in the stream, you know, same stream twice. It's constantly ebbing and flowing and changing. And we're seeing that right now. It's, you know, the market's really frothy. However, there's a bunch of banks that are at the end of their 3 year CRA cycle, which means they're done. And they've got 3 years to fill that bucket. And so what's going to happen is they're sitting back and saying, well, wait a second. You know, I don't want to pay $1.10 for a deal in Austin. I'm just going to wait. I don't have to. You know, I've got a couple more years. And if it's $1.10 in year two, well, then I'll pay it then. But let me just see what happens. Interest rates are going up. Maybe credit pricing's coming down. And I'll buy that deal next year at like $1.07. And that's what we're seeing right now. We're starting to see investors kind of pull back a little bit. So I think for Chris's plan of striking while the iron is hot and getting this deal going right now so he can lock in that high pricing, lock in those lower interest rates is very smart. So,
Dan, what's the highest price you've ever paid?
For me personally, I think the highest price that I have paid, I think it was $1.15.
So this one would be okay at $1.15.
It's a bargain.
Yeah. I think we had a question back in the back.
With the cost of the land and the mitigation on the EPA situation and the contingency on the easement, what do you anticipate your cost per door to be for the land?
Well, on this one, we're buying the site pretty cheap because of the issues. So we're only buying it for about $1.5 million. So just at the middle part of the page there. So we're buying it for $1.5 million, and then we've got to spend about $1 million to clean it up. And that's inside the construction cost here. On a per door basis, I guess that's, math's not too good in my head today, but it's less than $5 million.
Yeah. And then do you have to do a vapor barrier at all?
Yes, we do. We actually have to excavate to about 10 feet and then put a vapor barrier. But it's only in like a third of the site.
Gotcha.
So.
Okay. Oh, question?
Not in the state of Texas as well as you can in other places, but I'm not aware of any other programs that would allow you to do that.
I was just thinking as far as if you've got $1.5 million in land, then you're not getting tax credits on that because it's not an eligible basis. But the $1.5 million in site costs could be an eligible basis.
Oh, yes.
Sort of, right?
Yeah.
So you're getting a good deal.
The mitigation. So I'm getting 40 cents on every dollar I spend for that.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Which is good.
Yeah.
But question.
And at $1.15, it's 41. Back in the back.
I have a quick question. I noticed that you said 10% of the units were for 30% or less median family income.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the advantages and disadvantages of
doing that? Well, the main disadvantage of having that is the lack of income that you get. The second disadvantage is that the populations for 30% AMI generally have a need they're more demanding than your other tenants because they've been at a low level of poverty for a while. They may have been at homeless for a period of time. And so that is also something you have to take into consideration when you put 21 units of 30% AMI. I'd say the largest of affecting me as a developer is that if I was charging 30% more or, you know, the 60% AMI for those units, then I would be able to get a lot more rent, which would help to fill the gap. But the reason why we set those 30% AMI units is because it really gives a strong balance to the property where you can be able to help a wide band of incomes. So,
is there any sort of financial incentive for that? I mean, is it linked to the density bonus or what? I want you to do that, don't misunderstand me. But you know, what made that attractive?
For me, it makes it attractive because I think it's going to get the city of Austin to put more money into the deal.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And in essence, it's like you're going to get subsidized by that soft money, but to a certain extent, you're also subsidizing it with the market rate units. And we're seeing a lot more deals. You know, it used to be that everyone wanted 100% market, or excuse me, 100% LIHTC, because it's, you know, again, that perception of safety. But we're doing a lot more with market rate units in it. From a social perspective, I think it's fantastic. It's good to have that blend. Practically, I think it's great as well. You know, a lot of times you get overqualified tenants that come in and say, man, I want to live here, and you have to turn them away. So it's kind of nice to have that balance. Yes?
There's a push to house veterans and chronically homeless. Is there any tax incentives that go along with that?
There, you know, it really depends. And it's like, depending on which state you go to, some states may offer some soft financing behind it. You know, for Section 8, for instance, you've got the VASH voucher, which is geared toward veterans, which is good. But I got to tell you, quite honestly, the Section 8 vouchers are easier to get and work better. But typically that's what we're seeing. We're doing a lot more veterans deals, and I love them. They're fantastic. There's a lot of good groups that have been joint venturing with, you know, like a Center for Veterans Issues. We've got a couple deals we did up in Wisconsin. Great group run by a former general out of the Vietnam era. We love them. We love the guy. He's just phenomenal. And he joint ventured with a developer that does more of the type of, you know, LIHTC deals with a social component to it. And it's wonderful to see. And they'll try to locate those deals either in an urban setting where you're finding those veterans, or we did one up in Green Bay, which is, it's located right across the street from the VA hospital, which is really cool. So it's just a great way to serve our veterans. But
And we've done some where we use VASH vouchers and we project-base those. So it helps you to have some guaranteed income for those units, which makes the syndicator and the lender like the project better.
Mm-hmm.
On the deal that we did, though, we tried to keep the number of veterans units to like 10% of the total, because of, in my understanding of it, if you have too high of a concentration of veterans that are at risk of homelessness, you can have a project that could be at risk of having a lot of difficulties. So we actually, and with the City of Houston and Houston Housing Authority, put 10% on a project. So.
Yeah, it's really nice, and it's like, you know, and they work well both ways, you know. So whether you sprinkle some in within a small percentage of an overall deal, you're kind of being integrated. We did a deal up in Milwaukee, which was really cool. It was basically 100% vets, and there was a high demand there. And we actually, so it was a four-story building, and it had a commercial component that we white boxed the space. So we had to build out the light tech. We didn't want to include the commercial space. Separately, that nonprofit group raised money to put in a commercial kitchen. And right across the street was Marquette High School. And so the veterans are working in the kitchen, and they have a cafe. And it's really cool because you got a lot of the school kids that come over and eat at the cafe, and you've got these two generations mingling, and it's really neat. And so a lot of the veterans now have learned how to work in a kitchen, and they're getting jobs in the restaurants in downtown Milwaukee. So it's really neat. But those types of deals, it's definitely, it's all about management and the sponsorship. It's a different type of animal, and it's very intensive management.
And how about the chronically homeless?
It's same thing. It's like there's going to be a component of that where, you know, you mean chronically homeless veterans or chronically? It run very similarly. It's very management intensive, a lot of social services, and from the equity side as well as on the development side, you really need to understand who's paying for those social services, because that's the biggest thing. You can check off a box in an application and say, yeah, I'm going to lease this, you know, 30 units to, you know, this type of tenant base, but unless you've got the sources for those social services year in and year out, you could potentially have a huge issue. Yes. Back there.
Chris, it's kind of hard to see your slides, but it appeared you had a very impressive development fee. Is there a formula? What
kind of development? So the developer fee here, $5.356 million, and it's based upon a percentage of the total eligible basis. And so the total eligible basis, we took 15% of that. Total eligible basis is usually the direct hard cost, indirect construction cost, and the eligible financing fees that can be included. You total all those up, and about 15% of that is what you're entitled to get.
Great.
The impressive thing about this is that it won't be paid, so.
Did you have a question? Yeah.
Yeah, I did. And it's probably
developer CRM.
As a largely conventional product buyer, we've always had a negative view of rent, the ability to get rent from market rate units that are attached to a project that's also has income limitations.
Mm-hmm.
Because those folks don't want to live with potentially, or at least there's a perception about wanting to live with mentioned that you would tend to underwrite the market rate units at less than
right.
The market. Is that part of why?
Yeah, you know, it's funny because you do run into that from time to time. And I've got to say, it's like we used to see that a lot more. I don't know that we've seen it as much recently, but we do. We do feel like that discount is warranted just because, A, it's more from the market rate exposure, right? So when you have a downturn, the first rents that get hit are the market rate rents. That's really what's driving it. LIHTC actually, you know, when we went through the recession, this was horrific, right? LIHTC deals were full. And, you know, when you go to the Cohen-Resnick study, it's fascinating because it actually, if you look at it, because you guys did a study like before the downturn, and the numbers didn't look as good. It's amazing. So the LIHTC deals actually stayed full. We're doing fine. And all those first-time home buyers that lost their homes, they became LIHTC renters. You know, so but what you'll see in that recession is those market rents get hit first. Now the good thing is, you know, if we're wrong and the developer's right, which you know may happen from time to time, Diana, you get the benefit of that cash flow. So the tax credit investor is really just sitting there looking for the credits. So let's just say we underwrite his rents to $1,000 a unit and he ends up getting $1,500. That's all cash flow that goes to his bottom line. So, you know, it's not like he's completely foregoing it, but, you know, he'll get that out, you know, over time.
Goes to paying his deferred development.
Exactly, the big deferred developer fee.
I think, you know, I've seen what you're talking about, you know, where you have properties that are, like, let's say it's 80% of the units are tax credit and 20% are market rate. In all of the ones that we have like that, they are the market, the 20% market are fully leased and they're doing very well. And a lot of times we have a waiting list for those. But the difference though is that you have to build the units at the highest quality in the market.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they come in the door, they don't know if who there is low income.
Right.
One thing that's happening in today's market, and especially like in communities like Austin, there's the missing middle. And so if you look at Austin and you see your affordable rents at the 60% AMI, the leap from there to the units on the market,
mm-hmm.
it's dramatic. So we try to target that 80% AMI renter because they're the renter that cannot afford to go to Amelie and live, but they can live in our properties. They're paying the equivalent of market rent, but we're targeting those market rents to that 80% AMI. Not putting tax credits on, but we're serving that missing middle. And in Austin and some other cities, that's a big market right now.
Right. And it's a great point. And legislatively, they're talking about potentially doing something there. So income averaging out the property. So it's not necessarily, hey, I got a 30, I got a 60, but you can kind of average it out to try to capture some of that 80%.
Okay, so you guys got to wrap up this deal because
we still have
Mike talking about that's compliance smart. And 50% tests and all that kind of stuff.
Right. So as long as you get the additional sources, you know, to fill the hole, we're in for $110 all day long.
No. I thought we agreed about $15.
What? $115. I don't know. So we paid all like in year 15, then we're good.
So I thought the way I heard it was is that you're going to pay $1.15. She found me $1.2 million, and all I have to get is $2 million from the city. So.
Great, and then we get 50% of the developer fee, isn't that what we agreed?
Good deal. Okay, you're on.
You have a deal.
This is the guy that keeps him out of trouble, and me.
All right, this is the fun part. Only about 10 minutes left. Very short, so I'm going to buzz through a lot of the compliance issues surrounding the deal. So now we got awarded our credits. We have our investor lined up. We've got the site all ready to go. What's the next thing you have to do and be concerned about? For 9% deals only, there's a test that's called the 10% test. This is something that the IRS put in to basically shows that the project is progressing as expected. And so you have to get with your accountant and you submit a 10% report that's submitted to the state agency showing that you've incurred at least 10% of the cost. And so what you can incur is eligible items as well as some non-eligible items. So what I'm saying is that the basic you can incur could just be the land. That you can include as the amount incurred. It can be if you have even market rate units, you can incur that as costs. So the numerator is all basis incurred, and then your denominator in the calculation is what's called reasonably expected basis. And so this is really going to be your depreciable property plus land. Once you do that, you submit it, and you're good to go for a little while. So now, talked about that. So now, project is built. Everything is done. And we toss around this term called eligible basis. And why do you need eligible basis? That is the amount of cost that you need in order to support the amount of credits that you've asked from the state agency. And it's also the amount of credits that you promised your investor. So your accountants do what's called a cost certification. They're going to essentially go in and they're going to vouch all your costs. They're going to make sure that your sources and uses tie, and they're going to take all your total costs and are going to break them up into things that are eligible and not eligible. So once that cost certification is submitted to the state reviews it and then is going to issue what's called 8609s. Those 8609s is usually one of the things that you're going to get one of your last equity installments. And so once you have those in hand, now you're able to claim the credits on your tax return. So what is eligible basis? Eligible basis is all those costs, as I talked about before, and it's determined as of the end of the first year of the credit period. It includes your common areas, and you do get a boost if you're in certain qualified census tracts or difficult to develop areas. And usually a lot of the stuff is kind of all vetted out at the very beginning. So what are some things that can go into eligible basis? A lot of your, the stakes and breaks, so the acquisition, the architect fees, surveys, appraisals, construction costs, developer fees, a big thing. And those are all the ones that are just, pretty much a slam dunk. Now, items that aren't included, you can't claim credits on the land. Permanent loan fees, can't do that. Marketing, lease-up costs, tax credit fees, reserves, syndication fees. There's all these other costs that get factored into the total cost but are not eligible. And this is something that can definitely trip up our developer clients along the way, because if they did not pencil out that eligible basis number the correct way, you're looking at a tax credited adjuster. And that's something that I'm going to show you kind of generally how it works. Now, this is the fun part. These are costs that might be included in eligible basis. Now, there are guidance out there, and what's interesting is that state agencies actually handle eligible basis in different ways. Tenant relocation is a big one. New York, there's some of the agencies, no way will you get tenant relocation. Texas, I don't think they have much of a problem. They leave it up to the accountants to determine it. Now, there are IRS put out a couple years ago an audit technique guide on cost certifications. So they said flat out, you cannot have tenant relocations, your cost cert accounting fees, and items, and some other items into basis. However, those are just guidance. And so, as Cohen Resnick, I've been doing it for a number of years, there are certain type of tenant relocations that we feel like we still are able to include an eligible basis. So it's something that you really kind of want to vet out early on in the process. One thing that I added on here on the might be included is market studies. Usually you can always include market studies in an eligible basis, unless you're in Arizona. Arizona, you cannot include it. They actually have your little application sheet and it's grayed out. Market studies, no eligible basis. So every state's a little bit different. All right, so now the next test that we have here is our 50% test. This is very specific to bond deals only, okay? So the 50% test is really there to make sure that 50% of your project is going to be funded with the bonds. And so you're really looking at, when I say your aggregate basis, which is what we use as a denominator, very close to reasonably expected basis. It's going to be your depreciable basis plus your land. So these 50% tests are going to be calculated usually at the beginning when you do the bond issuance, and then later on when you do the cost certifications, it'll also be calculated to make sure it was done correctly. So one example, let's look here. So in this example, we have $10 million of bonds. What we're considering our aggregate basis, which again is our depreciable basis plus our land. This one, you pass, okay? Because you pass, you're able to take 100% of the eligible basis to arrive at your final eligible basis, okay? And this one kind of squeaked by with 50.25%. Now let's look at what happens if it doesn't qualify. Bad things happen. So same thing, $10 million of bonds, aggregate basis went up a little bit to $20.1 million. So you are underneath your 50% test ratio at 49.75%. And so what happens, you actually get half your eligible basis. So it's a cliff test. There are different mechanisms that are put in place to ensure that this does not happen. The worst one for the developers is to, well, let's just go limit your developer fee to make sure, shorten the developer fee to make sure that you get underneath that 50% threshold. But very important to make sure that you're doing it the correct way. Another bond rule is called the 95-5 test. This is also called a good cost, bad cost test. Essentially, you are able to use your bond costs for certain things. When I say bad costs, we're not talking about eligible and non-eligible. The bond rules have all sorts of different, very specific things related to it as terms of the percent of the land that can be used to be purchased by land. It has limitations on bond issuance costs. Looks at the average economic life and does all sorts of very strange things. This is something that, again, your accountant can perform for you. All right, now this is the fun part, the credit adjuster, okay? Which we see from the study that, for the most part, half the projects that have an adjuster, it's only 1% or less. This is something that's actually quite interesting for me because I'm kind of nerdy with this, but you know, with the credit being around for 30 years, you would think that there would be a standard credit adjuster language in the LPAs. But these things go all over the board, and they take an attorney like Chris to read this and interpret it for us, because they are just sometimes wacky. So, but generally, how this will work is you generally have two different kinds. You have a permanent adjuster and a timing adjuster. A permanent adjuster is essentially if you fall short of your eligible basis that will support the amount of credits you have, there will be your first adjuster, and that's the permanent adjuster. In this example, we projected that we're going to have federal tax credits of $750,000 per year. We actually ended up with just $700,000. All right, so $50,000 variance. Doesn't seem like much, right? Not a big deal. So, all right, well, the credit stream is over 10 years, so multiply by 10. And then you multiply that by the LP's ownership percentage of 99.99%. Your net variance to the LP is $499,000. And so, and then your downward basis adjustment factor, which could just be the syndication rate, is 0.9. So this example, you have a permanent adjuster calc of $449,955. So what happens to that? Well, usually the LPs will hold out their last equity installment for the amount of credits that are going to come in. They're going to say, okay, well, you're not going to get $449,000 right off the bat. I don't know when you lease these things up, but that's the first one, which is quite a bit. So a small variance leads to potentially a really big impact. So what can that do to the developer? Well, less equity usually means you have to defer more of your developer fee, which you guys don't want to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
No. Second one is a timing adjuster. So in this example, this is kind of in addition to the permanent adjuster, you have the timing adjuster. So you not only didn't deliver the total amount of credits, you did not deliver when you said you were going to deliver them. There was a delay, whatever, it was raining, flooding, tons of reasons. You just didn't deliver them fast enough. Okay, so in this example, you were projected to originally deliver $750,000 of credits in the first year. You actually only delivered in the first year $350,000. Okay, so you see my projected column. The adjusted column is essentially taking into account the permanent difference, which was that original $50,000. You're not going to double up on the adjusters for the permanent and the time. So this is just strictly the timing. And so That's the adjusted column. So you are at $700,000. You actually delivered 350. You've got your variance. And so in this particular partnership agreement, it was agreed upon early upon that the timing adjuster fraction is 0.65%, which takes into account time value of money, whatnot. But it's figured out up front. A lot of the times it's not like that. You know, usually sometimes they'll put in things such as, you know, compounded daily 6% over this, and then, you know, it gets complicated. This is one of the more easier ones, so I put it in as this. So your downward timing adjuster for this one is $227,000. And so you add that to your permanent adjuster, and that is the amount that the equity is going to be reduced. And that is a compliance in a nutshell.
Okay, any unanswered questions?
Yes.
This is from the bank that just non-based on the taxpayer market. Can you talk recently about the typical loan structure for these? I mean, is there a recourse to
On the loan side?
Right, go ahead.
I can talk about it very generally. The construction loan will be recourse. Mm-hmm. Well, it's recourse to the borrower, but then there are also guarantors that back it up. Usually the principal is in the deal. The permanent debt is non-recourse, although there may be non-recourse carve-outs, like basically bad boy acts.
Okay, we have enjoyed having you with us this morning, this afternoon. If you would, there is a some kind of a like evaluation sheet. If you would fill those out or take them with you and drop them at the reception desk somewhere, either one's fine. But I would like to really thank my panelists. They're very good sports for sticking with us today. And let's give them a big round of applause. Enjoy the rest of the conference. The TAP membership meeting starts at 3, and there's a speaker presentation that starts at 4:15, and then there's like drinks and reception and all that kind of stuff after that. So we're not separating you from the bar right now. There's several events after us that will take place before the bar. But thank you very much.